congregation may be seated. The congregation is asked to turn to page 12 in the front of the hymnal for the order of holy baptism. Page 12. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. Our Savior Jesus Christ commanded baptism when he said, "Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." All of us are born into this world for a deep need for baptism. From our parents, we inherit a sinful nature. We are without true fear of God and true faith in God and are condemned to eternal death. But Jesus took away our sin by giving his life on the cross. At our baptism, he clothes us with the robe of his righteousness and gives us a new life. Our sinful nature need not control us any longer. We recall what baptism means for our daily lives as we speak these words. Baptism means that the sinful nature in us should be drowned by daily sorrow and repentance, and that all its evil deeds and desires be put to death. It also means that a new person should daily arise to live before God in righteousness and purity forever. As baptized children of God, we confess our sins. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful, and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given his only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In obedience to the command of our Lord and trusting in his promise, you have brought this child to be baptized. Jesus told us, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these." It is in baptism that God grants the new life of forgiveness, joy, and peace to little children. By the power of God's word, this gracious water of life washes away sin, delivers from death and the devil, and gives eternal salvation to all who believe. Receive the sign of the cross on the head and on the heart to mark you as a redeemed child of Christ. Brooks Michael Gilbertson, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit has forgiven all your sins. By your baptism, you are born again and made a dear child of your Father in heaven. May God strengthen you to live in your baptismal grace all the days of your life. Peace be with you. Please rise. Brothers and sisters in Christ, our Lord commands that we teach his precious truths to all who are baptized. Christian love, therefore, urges all of us, especially parents and sponsors, to assist in whatever manner possible so that Brooks may remain a child of God until death. If you are willing to carry out this responsibility, then answer, "Yes, as God gives me strength."
Yes, as God gives me strength.
Let us pray. Merciful Father in heaven, we thank you for the blessing of baptism by which you offer and grant the forgiveness of sins, life, and salvation. Help us to regard our baptism as the robe of righteousness we are to wear all the days of our life. Look with special favor on Brooks and grant him a rich measure of your Spirit, that he may grow in faith and godly living. Make us willing to carry out our responsibilities to those who have been baptized, so that all of us may finally come to the blessed joys of heaven through Jesus our Lord.
Amen.
Depart in peace. Amen. The congregation may be seated for the scripture lessons. Our Old Testament lesson for today from Jeremiah chapter 9, beginning at verse 23. This is what the Lord says, "Let not the wise man boast of his wisdom, or the strong man boast of his strength, or the rich man boast of his riches. But let him who boasts boast about this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord who exercises kindness, justice, and righteousness on earth. For in these I delight, declares the Lord." So far the Old Testament lesson. Our psalm of the day, these words of Psalm 115. "Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name be the glory, because of your love and faithfulness." So far the psalm of the day. And our epistle lesson from Ephesians chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. "As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." This is the word of the Lord. Alleluia. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Alleluia. Holy Gospel is written in the 18th chapter according to St. Luke, beginning at the 9th verse.
Glory be to you, Lord.
To some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everybody else, Jesus told this parable. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. Pharisee stood up and prayed about himself. "God, I thank you that I'm not like other men, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week and give a tenth of all I get." But the tax collector stood at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven, but beat his breast and said, "God, have mercy on me, a sinner." I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. This is the gospel of the Lord. Let us join in confessing our faith according to the words of the Nicene Creed, as printed on page 18 in the front of the hymnal. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Christian, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Our special text on this Confirmation Sunday from Ephesians chapter 2, beginning at verse 8. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Some Bible passages are as fundamental as they are famous. Take, for instance, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. That passage, known as the gospel in a nutshell, is so well known that people sometimes put it on posters as John 3:16, hold it up at a football game without even spelling out the wording of the passage. Ephesians 2 8 through 10 is something like that. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves. This passage tells us what God has made us to be by grace through faith in Christ. It tells us that we are from start to finish God's masterpiece, His work of art, once ruined by sin but now restored by grace. It is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves. It is the gift of God. Grace is one of those words that sometimes can degenerate into mere jargon, a buzzword of the trade, into a sort of shop talk of religion. We may assume that we know what the word grace means. We may assume that others think of the same thing when they use and hear the word grace. Grace is not an ability which is poured into you or infused into you to enable you to do good works to score points with God. Grace is God's undeserved love. It is His gift. Grace is not just getting something for nothing. Grace is getting the very opposite of what we had coming. This is what makes grace so amazing, that as St. Paul said, where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. We will never appreciate grace until we also acknowledge sin. Adam and Eve in the beginning were created in God's image, thinking the thoughts of God after Him. But then they ruined the masterpiece. They destroyed God's work of art. And they succumbed to the temptation to trade God's love for Satan's lie. You will be like gods. Take charge of your own life. Chart your own course. Do your own thing. Be the God of your own life. Call your own shots. And they did. And the human race has been paying for it ever since, in its aimless, prodigal wanderings from God. We will never appreciate grace until we truly believe what happened back there in the Garden of Eden when the world was young. That in fact, as Paul says earlier in this chapter, because of that, we are now dead in transgressions and sins. We have in fact lost the image of God. We have no further relationship with God by nature. And until we really come to appreciate and understand that, we will never really appreciate what it is Christ has done for us. We will never really appreciate forgiveness if we believe there is no sin to be forgiven. Then Christ died for no reason at all. We see the marks of this trashing of God's masterpiece everywhere in our own lives, in our wicked ways, in our family fights, in our constant rebellion against God and our pride. We see the marks of this destruction in its fallout on the world. A broken creation where there's crib death and cancer and constant problems all the time, and wars and rumors of wars. All this we see. We are dead in transgressions and sins. Now that is a revolutionary thing that swims upstream against everything that you are hearing on TV and reading on the blogs, that
We are not born basically good, inherently noble, with only maybe a few little minor blemishes. And whatever evils there really are, well, maybe those are just the result of society. By the way, society is made up of people. Or of our environment. Or of some glitch in the evolutionary development of our glands. No. Dead in transgressions and sin. Kind of like the kid who watched his dad lop off the head of a chicken, and then the thing is running all over the barnyard. And he says, "Look, Daddy, he's dead, and he doesn't know it." Older people may think of that movie, Night of the Living Dead, you know, spiritual zombies. More recent generations of that movie, The Sixth Sense, where the little kid Cole says to Malcolm, his psychiatrist, "I see dead people." And Malcolm says, "You mean in your dreams?" Cole shakes his head, "No." "You mean dead people like in graves and coffins?" And the boy shakes his head, "No." Walking around like regular people, they don't see each other. They only see what they want to see. And they don't know that they're dead. "Well, how often do you see them?" said Malcolm. "All the time. They're everywhere. And so the world you see is full of bleached bones, of dead people walking around, perhaps entirely active and involved and happy in whatever it is they're doing, but they're dead." The beating heart of God's love is that we are no longer dead. God made us alive in Christ through the gospel waters of baptism, through the preached word, through the body and blood of the holy sacrament. He brought us to life and maintains that life so that we now have a life with God. So that it is by this grace that we are saved. This is what sets Christianity, biblical Christianity, in contrast to every other religion on the face of the earth. I know Aunt Tilly over the potato salad says, "Well, all religions are pretty much alike as long as you're sincere." No. This is what sets Christianity apart from all other religions. That we are saved not by what we do, but by what Christ did for us. By his fulfilling of the commandments we haven't kept, by the death he died that should have been ours, by his triumphant resurrection on Easter, so that the cemetery itself no longer has power over us, and we have the power of an indestructible life here and hereafter. It is by grace you have been saved through faith, says Paul. We come to enjoy this grace, this forgiveness, this pardon that was won for all people when we come to personally believe it. And even this faith is not something of our doing. It is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this faith, not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. We didn't come to believe in Christ because we surrendered to Christ, because we made a decision for Christ. No. We were brought to faith in Christ because God the Holy Spirit in his mercy raised us from spiritual death to spiritual life. You really don't think, do you? When Lazarus was dead in his grave and Jesus said, "Lazarus, come forth," that Lazarus kind of helped out a little? That he lay there and say, "Well, I'm a little stiff, but I think I can wiggle my toe." No, dead is dead. And you can't help yourself. You were brought to faith by grace. And even the faith that believes it and lays hold upon it is God's gift to you. "You did not choose me," said Jesus. "I chose you." No one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. And so here we have it. A religion that is totally by grace. It is the heart and core of what the Bible teaches. That we are not saved by what we do. We are saved by what God in Christ Jesus has done for us, by his undeserved love. This is the doctrine, the teaching by which the church stands and falls.
It is what we teach our confirmands, and if they or we ever lose it, we have lost it all. We have banished God from the bridge of the ship, and that means shipwreck. It is by grace. You say, well, then what place do good works have in the life of a believer? Surely we all know people who talk the talk, but do not walk the walk. Surely we know licensed Lutherans who have turned their liberty from sin into a perverse license to sin. Surely we know that the temptation for Lutherans is to sit back and say, well, I'm a Lutheran, saved by grace through faith, so I'll sit on my Lutheran derriere and do nothing. No. That is not an option for someone who truly believes in Christ Jesus. It is not an option to stand before God's altar, to pledge undying allegiance to your Savior and to His Word, and then to just say you're going to fall off the radar and tell God, don't call me, I'll call you. We are, says St. Paul, God's workmanship, His masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus to do good works which God has prepared in advance for us to do. Yes, we are God's masterpiece, created. You know, the word created has behind it the idea that this is something only God can do. We are created in Christ Jesus to do good works. Now, who gets the credit for a beautiful painting? Canvas? The paint? The brush? No. We even refer to famous paintings by the names of the men who painted them. A Michelangelo, a Rembrandt, a Picasso. Who gets the credit for a novel? A famous poem? The paper? The ink? The pen? Of course not. We give the credit to, well, that's a Hemingway or a Shakespeare. So also, we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, not of ourselves, but, well, because as Luther said in his own way, you don't have to lecture a pear tree to have pears. As apple trees have apples and the sun shines and water is wet, so Christians bring forth what we refer to as the fruits of faith. Now, while grace is a done deal, our forgiveness is a done deal. It is finished, said Jesus. Our life as Christians, this bringing forth the fruits of faith, being God's workmanship created to do good works, that is always a work in progress, isn't it? We're duking it out with our old sinful nature all the time. It is something that we continue to struggle with as long as we live, which is all the more reason why we must stay close to the Word of God. Now, some educators will tell you that they believe that education is sort of ratchet-based. A ratchet's the kind of thing that keeps the forward-turning spring from going backward. It only goes forward. So ratchet-based would mean, well, a kid gets older, never younger. Our thinking gets more complex, not more simple. We grow bigger, not smaller. But that does not so much apply to the life that we have in Christ as God's workmanship. It is true that sometimes, but sadly not always, a person who is 90 knows more about their Savior and loves Him more dearly than when they were 19. But it is also true that the faith of some little children is the envy of any jaded adult. And there are a lot of adults back there, out there, who should go back to the simple faith of their childhood. It's not ratchet-based. You can lose it. You can go backward. You can backslide. And lose what you had. Someone has mentioned that you would notice this if you watched the life of King David. I mean, the peaks of faith that he was at when he went down into the valley of Elah against that giant Goliath. And that abyss of failing on the rooftop of his house when he gave way to lust and eventually led to the adulterous affair and the murder of one of his best soldiers. It's not ratchet-based. It is possible if you do not stay close to Christ that you begin to go backward. We are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works which God prepared in advance for us to do. God has certain things He wants you to do. Long before you were born, even though you may not come to know it, there are certain things God has prepared for you and me to do during our lives. Out of faith in Christ. Now that might be loving your spouse or cleaning the house. That might be the way you do your homework. Or it may be how you help a downhearted neighbor. There are all kinds of things, from your job to your everyday life and your family to your school, that God has prepared in advance for you to do. Whether it's sharing the scriptures, reading your Bible, helping someone down and out, all of these things are works prepared in advance. Opportunities for you and for me. Now, what an adventure God has in store for you and me. Don't miss out on it. As the old line goes, stay connected to Jesus. Amen. The peace of God which surpasses all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us offer up our prayers today for Ray Horseman, who will undergo minor surgery in Rochester on Friday. O Lord, you are the great physician of soul and body. You chasten and you heal. We pray that you would look with mercy on your servant and restore his strength. You gave your son to bear our infirmities and sicknesses. Deal compassionately with him and bless the medical means employed on his behalf with your healing power. We commit him to your gracious mercy and protection, for you are a faithful and merciful God for Jesus' sake, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We continue with the communion portion of the service, beginning on the top of page 23 in the front of the hymnal. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take and eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Shed for the remission of all your sins. strengthen and preserve you in the true faith unto life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen.
Let us pray. O God, the Father, source of all goodness, in your loving kindness you sent your Son to share our humanity. We thank you that through him you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. We also pray that you will not forsake us, but will rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, so that we willingly serve you day after day. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Thank you.
has informed us that he is returning, that is declining the call that we extended to him as to serve as our principal. The voters will meet 2 weeks from today, Sunday, May 31st, at 1 o'clock downstairs to extend another call. There is no fellowship hour today because of confirmation. Please greet each other.